fertility treatment for trans and non-binary persons. Hey friends, welcome back. I am Dr. Natalie Crawford. I am a reproductive endocrinology and infertility specialist. That means I am double board certified in OBGYN and REI. And I am inclusive AF. So if you are going to come on here and listen and watch this video and come put hate in the comments, you're not welcome. So yes, I did just start out that way because this video is about access to fertility care by trans and non-binary people. And this is a huge issue and something that needs to be talked about more. But I believe my job is not to determine who should be a parent, but to help anybody who wants to be a parent become one. And one of the coolest things about my job is that as a fertility doctor, there are so many different paths to parenthood. There are different combinations of gametes, that means eggs and sperm, those are your gametes. There is a uterus that can carry a pregnancy, and my job is to put the pieces all together to help people become parents. Being inclusive is really important to me. You being able to be open and honest with who you are is really important to me. You should be able to come to my office or any fertility doctor and say, this is me, this is who I am, this is what our ideal family should look like, and we should be able to try to help you make that happen without judgment or without denying you the right. This is not historically what has been the case for trans people. I'm going to talk a little bit from an ethics committee guideline. This is access to fertility services by transgender and non-binary persons, an ethics committee opinion. So this has been put out by ASRM, the American Society for Reproductive Medicine. And I'm going to highlight a few things because I do think sometimes we don't realize what people go through. And I love seeing an inclusive world, and we're seeing more people become comfortable and coming out with who they really are. But there has been so much discrimination, especially when it comes to building a family. Before I dive in, I'm going to go over just a few terminology words, because one thing is you may be here and you may be watching this, and maybe you don't understand some of this, and that's okay. Maybe you didn't grow up in a house where this was talked about. Maybe this was not something you learned in school. We all know sex ed can be lacking. So let's just go over some very basics about inclusivity and sex and gender, and then we can break down what some of this means. So sex is a chromosome thing. It is the chromosome sex you're born with. So your chromosomes don't have a gender, they have a sex. So you have two sex chromosomes, X and Y. You can be XX, and that'd be a female sex, and you can be XY, and that's a male sex. In reality, there are actually a lot of different variants of this. So for example, there's something called androgen insensitivity syndrome. And so that is somebody who chromosomally is XY. So they have male sex chromosomes. However, because their bodies don't have the ability to process androgens because the receptors don't recognize testosterone, they develop completely female. And it's not until there is absence of a period or amenorrhea at puberty that it is actually recognized and diagnosed as a sex chromosome disorder. And so that is just one example of all the different types of differences that exist. So when somebody says, oh, there's just two sexes and that's natural. Gosh, in nature, there are so many different rearrangements of things that are very interesting. You have a syndrome of Turner syndrome is typically when you just have one X chromosome, you didn't inherit the other one. So are you really female? You didn't have two X's? And then what about Turner syndrome variants? So really simply, what we talk about when you're sex, what your sex assigned at birth, is really just an evaluation of what your genitals are when you were born. Because what happens in order to be phenotypically how you look, you have to have a genetic code, and then it has to be able to be interpreted by making hormones, genes have to work, hormones have to be made, receptors have to recognize the hormones, and there are so many different things that can go wrong along the way. So we first need to disconnect the idea that there is just two sexes. It's just not accurate. Gender is how you identify. We like to say that that sometimes is a social construct. I was born female and I identify as a female, so this is called cis. I'm a cis female. I was born this way and I identify this way. If somebody doesn't identify with how they were born, they are called trans. So these are actually scientific words. They come from molecules. So cis is on the same side and trans means on the opposite side. So it's really not a made up anything. It just means you identify not as what you were assigned at birth, regardless of what your chromosomes are. Assigned at birth, how you identify now. Now, trans people can be in various states. They may want to transition to that gender to feel more like themselves. They may feel perfectly fine like themselves without transitioning. And what does that mean? It can, one, mean dressing as what might socially be accepted as that gender, but it also may mean undergoing surgery. So there's top surgery where you could have breast implants or reconstruction to have breasts removed. And then there's bottom surgery in addition to hormone management. And hormone management is really crucial because this is what often makes people feel the best and helps them identify with that gender and have some of the what we call secondary sex characteristics of a feminine or a masculine shape that is often desired. And then when we talk about if you're a trans male or a trans female, we're always talking about the gender that you are identifying with. So a trans male is somebody who went female to male. You'll sometimes see it abbreviated in scientific literature, FTM, but that means they were assigned the birth of a female and now they identify as a male. So they are trans male. We are always calling people how they want to be identified now. A trans female was assigned the sex of a male and now is M to F, male to female, identifies as a female. So trans male, male, trans female, female, was born the other way. The trans is how they are now. Okay, let's get it right. It matters to people. Okay, back to the committee opinion. I want to read this because this just blows my mind and is shocking. I didn't grow up in a house that talked about trans people. It's not that anybody was discriminatory. It just wasn't something that was ever brought up. I don't even think I knew what the meanings of these words were. So I understand why some people don't understand this when they come to that. And the unknown is sometimes scary. But this to me is outrageous that medical professionals are withholding care. So just listen to this. Patients who differ from the heteronormative family have historically been denied access to assisted reproductive technology, or ART. Although there is growing acceptance of the use of ART by gay and lesbian parents, some providers express discomfort about providing fertility services for transgender patients. Although ART programs may receive requests for fertility treatment or fertility preservation from transgender persons, programs vary in their acceptance of such patients. Resistance to providing treatment is typically grounded in either concern for the welfare of the patient or concern for the welfare of the offspring, or both. Some programs believe it is unacceptable to treat any transgender persons. Some programs may provide services only for FTM, transgender male, patients with female partners because of reservations about treating all transgender patients. Increasingly, physicians, psychologists, and ethicists have argued that transgender patients should have access to the same options as any person who will lose or might lose their reproductive capacity. Look at what we're up against. There are actually fertility doctors out there who will just say no, they won't see you. They won't help you preserve your fertility if you're undergoing a transition. This is mind-blowing. And out of concern for the welfare of the child, are you kidding me? Okay, well, let's just break this down in science really fast. So there have been studies looking at the welfare of offspring who are raised in homes with a transgender parent. Now, older literature, most people transitioned at later phases in their life previously. So older literature showed children that had a parent go through the transition when they were already a child. So they made that transition later because it wasn't as socially accepted. Now we are seeing people transition before they start their family planning, and that's fabulous. And there have been studies, and I will link them in the show notes, there is no adverse effect to the children. They are healthy, well-adjusted, have no issues with relationships, and no higher rate of psychosis, identity disturbance, or impairment in psychosocial functioning. I can't even believe I have to say that out loud, but there we go. Evidence, data, you know I love it. So the data supports you can be raised in a home with a transgender parent without any concern for your well-being. So let's just take that off the list. Okay, the other argument is for the well-being of the patient. And I think this is because some providers maybe don't understand or they don't know. Let's talk about what happens when we talk about preserving your fertility before the transition. Sometimes surgery for transition removes the ability to have future fertility. And I'm a big believer that how you feel at the current moment may not be how you feel in the future. You may be in a relationship in the future with a partner who having children is very important to them. It may not feel as important to you right now. And you're always safest by keeping doors and options open. Okay, so a transgender male patient, what will actually happen in the transition stage is multiple things. One is starting testosterone treatment. Testosterone treatment actually shuts down the ovaries. It's like birth control. It tells the brain to not send out any sex hormones, so the ovaries go into a quiet state. It's also going to cause masculinization. And some people actually undergo a gonadectomy, or they have their ovaries removed or their uterus removed. So if you have your uterus removed, you can no longer carry a child. You can, if you have a uterus, carry a child, no matter how you identify. So sometimes we do counsel people about keeping their uterus in case this is something that potentially they would want to do in a future relationship or in the future, and just using hormone management to not have a period. That way they're not having to deal with periods since they're identifying as a male. We also are seeing ovaries taken out. And so if your ovaries are taken out, obviously you are losing your eggs. You are not going to be able to have genetic children if your ovaries have been removed. Being on testosterone is ovarian suppressive. And so there was initial fear about trying to do egg freezing when you're on testosterone treatment. And I'll even admit, since my course, I used to make patients come off T completely. And now I've even done some cases where that's just not worth it to the patient, and we stimulate them even though they're on testosterone. The reality is we don't have long-term data on that, although it appears that it's not going to be harmful. If it's not going to be harmful and it's better tolerated for the person to not have to come off of their hormone management, why are we not all for that? However, anytime you're making eggs, you're going to make estrogen and you're going to feel a little bit different. And so the easiest time to undergo egg freezing is going to be before transition, because it's going to be an easier process for you. You do have vaginal ultrasounds most of the time. You're going to have frequent exams, and that is usually easier before you're fully transitioned, or just being aware that that's going to be a part of the process. Probably most programs have people come off of hormones for about 30 days, testosterone for about 30 days to wake the ovaries up. We've even seen similar literature in patients who've been on birth control pills for a really, really long time, that the ovaries may be so suppressed that they won't respond to treatment appropriately. And truly, egg freezing costs money, and so we want it to be successful. I could get on a soapbox about how I feel like all transgender males should be able to have egg freezing covered as part of insurance, as part of natural, this is fertility preservation, just like cancer patients should. They're gonna undergo treatment that's going to make it harder for them to get pregnant without assisted reproductive technology, so why are we not helping more people have families? If you're really pro-life, don't you want more families to exist, more people to be able to experience parenthood? It just doesn't make sense to me. Having children is natural. My job is natural. I use science to help people become parents, a very natural thing. If you are a trans male and you have a uterus and you would like to carry a baby, we love that. I'm lucky in Austin to have my first trans male patient who'd like to carry a baby, so like come on our way at Fora. But what we're saying is that that's totally doable. You will have to take estrogen. We will have to get the uterine environment correct. You will have pregnancy hormones. It'll be kind of crazy. But if that feels like the way you want to make your family, we are all for that. For those people who are trans women or trans female, this means that they were assigned the sex of male and now they identify as a female. And so we recommend sperm freezing. Sperm freezing is so cheap compared to egg freezing. There's really no reason why we shouldn't encourage this. So similarly, when you go on hormone treatment, you're going to be having estrogen that's going to help you have some feminizing features and feel your best self, but that is going to plummet your sperm counts. And so we can, though, often still have sperm in very low amounts, but enough for an IVF cycle, even in some patients who are on exogenous hormones. However, if you are going to have a gonadectomy, meaning you're going to have your testes removed as part of your bottom surgery, then you should freeze sperm. Please freeze sperm before you undergo your surgery. Anybody who is going through a transition, anybody who's diagnosed with cancer, anybody who has endometriosis, people who have diseases or who have medical situations or taking treatments, no matter what they are, that are going to impact your future fertility, you should see fertility doctors. We are nice. Well, minus those people in here who said they're refusing care. They're not nice. But most of us, I am here to help you. There are options which will hopefully be available in the future, which should help people, such as freezing of tissue from pre-puberty patients. That would probably help even more people, as we're seeing those transition earlier. A lot of those are still experimental as of right now. We are seeing a lot of stigma, a lot of discrimination, even in states passing laws against healthcare services and protecting the rights of our trans people. It is one of my strongest beliefs that anybody who wants to be a parent should be able to do so. Being a mom myself is one of my greatest joys and is one of my biggest honors to help my patients become parents. However you identify, whatever your relationship status is, I don't care. It should not matter if you are single, partnered, gay, lesbian, trans, whatever fits your life, great. come to us. Let us be creative with you. Let us talk about all the options, whether it includes a gestational carrier, donor eggs, donor sperm, donor embryos, fertility preservation, going through ART or IVF while you're undergoing your hormone treatments. But please, if you or somebody you love is transgender, support them. I'm supporting you. Please, if you know somebody who is undergoing transitioning, ask if they've seen a fertility doctor. Help them find one. Volunteer to go to appointments with them. Learn to mix medications. Help somebody out along this process. That means more than you could ever know. Thank you guys so much. I would love it if you would subscribe to this channel. I'm going over tons of fertility-based information and facts, and I love your support. As always, you can get more information on the As a Woman podcast, or you can follow along on Instagram at Natalie Crawford, MD. Thank you.